Tower, 7868 copy command. Six clients. Just kind of check, you know, is delay, or is delay, you know, keep the communication channel open. So, this time, you know, potato, six letters for the server. So the server sees, okay, if the make one, these six letters, potato. So he returns it back to the client, and that's fine. And then she does it again, you know, then she says four letters, and these are four letters per, and so returns it back to the client. That's fine. So now, so I was still there, gives a reply with half, 500 letters. And then, you know, the server thinks, you know, yeah, make one, these 500 letters, half, and then rest of here. And here, the server will return the half, and also the content after the half string in memory. So that's the different problem here, like that. By sending in, you know, a short string, but specifying what I want, you know, this is actually larger, you can actually expose and get out about 64 kilobytes of memory data in a response. So it's really pretty bad. And it looks like you can use the private keys if it's been, you know, been leaked. You know, tried it? You should not try it. But the final thing is actually 9,000 keyboards checked. So I wonder, you know, if we go here again now and see, I'm going to check, you know, why not do the process here, you know? Now we've got security, so, you know, people do expose these, you know, hacks. So, yeah, so that's kind of the service. If it's vulnerable, you can run various scanners against your own system, like it's a lab that will test. So this
thank you.
test in a domain like Elements of DNN. That is one. And it will do checks against the HTTPS implementation on my server to see if I have, you know, good or bad settings. Because there's quite a lot of different settings that you can set when you configure HTTPS. So you can use, you know, protocols and the crypto ciphers to use and other things. And if you do it too tight, you might lose a few clients. And so it's a balance of who your clients are that you have to kind of look at to see how strict should it be and how, you know, lockdown should be, because there's a few, you know, weak crypto standards in the HTTPS and a few, you know, stronger ones. So if you run this thing, I should get pretty good. I've got an A at least, and I've got a few, you know, bits here to work on. If I want a higher kind of score, I have to kind of try to limit the kind of cryptos that I accept. And then I will exclude more and more clients, like older Android phones. So it's a balance of, you know, locking the door for, you know, old clients. And so I can see here that if accumulated with some older, like IE6, you know, XP, then I'll have some problems, and IE8 on XP. So, and if you tighten the crypto set more, or, you know, clients will fail in this list here. So, and I'm just going to do a test here to check if I'm exposed to a hard bleed, you know, vulnerability, and in this case, I'm not. So, it's in general a good tool to test your setup. And it's really nice because I have this extensive program test practice, a short PI, on how you should, the best practice on how to deploy and help your HTTPS configuration. That's another thing, if you're into HTTPS, you have a HTTPS pulse that will give you a statistical summary of the state of HTTPS on the web. So you can see how many is, you know, the score, how many is S fail, and how many is A good, and, you know, and you can see how the key metrics are on. So you can compare, you know, what everybody else is using on the web today. So this can be interesting statistics as well to use. So, to having, you know, scanning the system. And there's a lot of, you know, small tools that you can use to you know, test if you don't have this heartbeat vulnerability specifically. But it is, again, there's many tools to check for this bug on the web today. But the main problem with this heartbeat bug is that it's more or less undetectable, because it's not nothing but logged by usually. It's not something that's logged usually by the web masters of the site. It's something within the HTTPS itself, and that's without the kind of scope for your log files, unless you have some extensive firewall or some intrusion detection system. So it's not logged. So you can just, you know, hit the servers with as many requests as you like, just because nobody will notice more or less. It's, you know, seen it.
Firefox and Explorer have it
to enable it by default. So what we perform to instead, we have this kind of compiled list of the downloads like once in a while to refresh the local list of, you know, in other certificates. So it's not, you know, always my automation. So what you do, you know, scan your network to find OpenSSL installation. A scanner, there's a preemptive event at one, it's called NMAP. It's a very famous network scanner. NMAP. So there should be, you know, hopefully, we have a better supposed to be some hopefully extension to NMAP. And NMAP is one of the kind of effective tools for scanning an open port for devices and open ports. So they have some addition to check for the hot speed attack. So, scanning network, update the OpenSSL installation, get your certificate from the book, the old ones, give a date session, today to OpenSSL if you use it, because it's, I think we need the money right now to fix the issues. Questions? So, we continue a little bit more, I'm going to take a break in like 10-15 minutes, okay? So, man in the middle attacks. Everyone been hit by one. We don't know, perhaps. So, a man in the middle attack is when a hacker somehow gets between you every time and the server that you're talking to. And, you know, if a hacker also pretend to be the server, he can do a lot of damage. Like, it would be like a bank or Facebook or something else. And, today it's simple to do your own man in the middle attack because you can just, you know, buy in the Wi-Fi router and do some configuration of it. And you get tired to connect to it and you just sit in the middle and listen to it. And that's pretty easy today by today's standards. And when you just quickly see why the hotspot and then, you know, keep connect to it and, you know, just not listen to the traffic, yeah, and that's good enough. Or if I want to hack, you know, your company, I keep in the calls and then they've got some outside access and access free Wi-Fi, keep in the call with the antenna, you know, people are connecting to it, and we just record all the traffic and I go home and analyze it, you know. It's pretty kind of efficient to do. So, what you do as a hacker, you know, when you can hear the session cookies, and if you have the session cookies, you can obviously need to be the user that's, you know, being attacked, and so you can sort of, you know, continue the session on the site, as the person that was kind of hit by the attack. And instead of changing information, you know, in this case, someone didn't like, someone was stealing his bandwidth, so he made a proxy that flipped all the images upside down. And it's pretty simple, you know, innocent kind of hack, you know, just to annoy the person being, you know, trying to kill your Wi-Fi. And so you actually inject JavaScript into your page. And I think that is the really sad thing, because if you get the hacker's JavaScript into your page, you're pretty kind of toast. You're kind of, lost. So it's a really big thing, and you know, it's really, really easy because you just need to have this kind of device here. That's how you do it. And the thing is, this Ring Main device for just a mail attack costs like $150 to buy in the US. Pre-made, pre-configured, just one to go. And the other thing is that many of your phones, they set up links on the Wi-Fi to check, you know, master call, are you there? SE, are you there? My home network, are you there? Please respond. And, or home one. And what might like to do is that, yes, my home one, please connect to me. And your phone might connect to it automatically without you knowing it. So, let's see how I think, who is calling my network here. So, I log into this device. Hot, game stamps, Scott and Alfred, iPad, Michael, Android, someone recognize those. So they are calling my device here. So what happens is that phones will start pinging out, you know, Sigma Gear, Sigma Pad, MyCloud, Tiva Gateway, High Angle, FCA. They will start pinging out those, you know, networks, are you there? And my device will, you know, will, in some cases, when it's not, you know, the company's not password, the kind of unencrypted Wi-Fi, if you kind of, in some cases, connect to this device. So they'll zoom, they'll get, you know, and you see they're scanning for different, you know, SSIDs. J-Focus, some of the J-Focus, recently. So this one, you know, your phone's connected to this one, and this one to my computer, and this connected to the internet, so you can actually search on the web. You can also, if you want to, so see here, you know, free Wi-Fi, that's something, you know, you must, you know, use. If actually, you'd like to connect to that one, and see what happens. So, yeah, right. So, I got Wireshark. So wire charge is a turbulent cause of traffic on the display level between the device and the web. So I can see when they connected it, someone went to between GW image and Skidoi something and Instagram and the quest. And I can look at the quest and, you know, look at the headers and all the details. And maybe from that you can, you know, see some cookies and so on. And it's that's quite bad. But there's more things that I can do here. So there's something called the SL strip. Well, that's that. If you can go to this nice module, you can see the image of the SE, so do you want to have it? Yeah, so there we're going to visit this one. I have to name it. So, yeah, let's. So, bottom here, I have this, secure link. So, what it does is if I go with it, it goes to HTTPS, www.pedgeman.se, and that's OK. And if I click on it, I go to the secure edition of this site, of this link. What it's not stripping does is it removes, when a page is coming back through my device, it will remove all the HTTPS in the link with the HTTP through my client, not be encrypted. So if I were to go on an iPad or something through to this site, through my Wi-Fi here, through this page and click on the link, I would be directed to the HTTP version instead, not the HTTPS. So that's the next step. And by doing that, the server thinks that it's encrypted, but the client here thinks that it's not encrypted. And the server will not notice anything. And the client, the only thing what he would notice is that he would be going to www.elements.se without the actual jump here. He just goes to the non-encrypted version instead. So that's what it's really much. Of course, we shouldn't do that. But anyway, so. That's very fun. So basically, I would get to element.se instead. So it's a way for me to be in the middle between, the client. And I can get an unencrypted communication channel between the client and this device. And then I can just stop recording all the traffic that I like and stuff. And you as a user will probably not notice it. The second thing that I can do is I can go into the software bar and I can go to the DNS. Let's see. Loading. Yes. This is the same machine that is working there. And nothing more, but that's just a Wi-Fi and some Wi-Fi interface and so on. So I think it's time to take a break now. 5-10 minutes break, get some beer, more pizza, and continue with the hacking experience. You make that non-encrypted here, but encrypted here. So the server thinks that you're encrypted, but the browser is in HTTP land, and secure land. So, and I say it's pretty hard to protect against this because the only thing you do is take your padlock and basis, look at the VPN tunnel or something like that. Yes, you can do that. But the hacker, at least in control, if you remove it, the browser will not get that header. So, that's really not the solution. So it's a really kind of that way. So a trade-off between flexibility and maybe you can always have certificates on the client and on the server, make it really secure, but then, you don't get have achieved to the site. So, straight up between convenience and security.